Welcome to Plotline Rundown, where we look at classic comic book plotlines and give you a summary so you can pick up on modern references to them. Also, hopefully go out and read them yourself. Unsurprisingly, I am a huge Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fan, which is why I got so excited to see this in the episode I Spy. Know what that is? That is Skrull writing. It doesn't translate to anything, but it is clearly the language used by the Skrull in the comics. Now see what this is? That's been confirmed to be a Kree, which we also saw more of in Guardians of the Galaxy. So, being a Marvel fanboy, I see Skrull, and I see Kree, and I can't help but think of the Kree-Skrull War. The Kree-Skrull War was a plotline in the Avengers issues 89 through 97, published in 1971, and potentially one of the most important plotlines in the Marvel Universe, with repercussions spreading all the way to 2011's Secret Invasion. Let's start by looking at the stats. Main heroes, we have the Avengers, Rick Jones, and Captain Marvel. Main villains, Ronan the Accuser and, to a lesser extent, the Kree and Skrull Empires. Number of issues, 9. Barrier to entry. This is my rating for how easy it is for somebody who knows very little about the comics to pick it up, with low being a first issue to impossible being a major event like Crisis on Infinite Earths. In this case, I would say that's a medium-level difficulty. There are a lot of references to other books and events, not to mention the makeup of the Avengers that most people will be unfamiliar with, but if you're patient, all these things are explained within a page or two in most cases. We open with an entirely not-suspicious man in a trench coat and white hair being noticed by the Avengers Quicksilver, Scarlet Witch, and Vision, the strangest menage a trois in comic books. Skulky McTrenchcoat reveals that he is none other than Captain Marvel! Oh my god, I never saw that reveal coming. They fight, Captain Marvel shows off his awesome alien sound effects, and on the next page we have... another reveal! So far this comic is all surprise guest stars. This time it's Rick Jones, sidekick to the stars, and man at fault for Bruce Banner being the Hulk. Rick shoots Mar-Vell and the Avengers spirit him away in a Quinjet while Rick feels bad about what he did, Wanda feels bad about Mar-Vell being an alien and she being a mutant, and Vision feels bad about being an android. Everyone's life sucks right now. The Avengers bring Marvel to a creepy lab and hook him up to something which triggers a flashback. Get used to these. This is where we learn that Rick has been sidekicking with Captain Marvel after a brief stint being trained by Captain America. Marvel's been stuck in the negative zone and can only come back to our world when Rick smashes his negabands together to trade atoms with him for about 3 hours at a time. But Rick hasn't been letting him out lately, instead focused on his career as a... folk singer. Whatever. Captain Marvel bugs him telepathically because Reed Richards just got out of the negative zone, so he clearly has a machine that allows passage, and this is a chance for Marvel to get out. So Rick goes to the Baxter building, where Marvel pulls a lot of dick moves. The FF aren't home, so the Avengers answer the security alarm and find Marvel opening a doorway to let Rick through. But it accidentally also lets through Annihilus, who monologues his way to defeat, and Marvel steals the Quinjet, heading to Cape Canaveral to hijack a spaceship back to Kree space. But we learn now why the Avengers brought him to the creepy lab. Spending so much time in the negative zone means that being in this world makes him unstable. They fix him thanks to the Vision, but both Vision and Marvel are unconscious. Meanwhile, back on the Kree homeworld Hala, Ronan the Accuser takes control from the Intelligence Supreme by saying his name a lot and insisting he's in charge. Sound strategy, Ronan. His accusiness activates a long-lost Kree sentry that just happens to be in Florida and sends it after Mar-Vell. Issue 2 picks up where we left off. There's a fight that the Avengers lose, and the sentry absconds with the unconscious Captain Marvel. But, more importantly, ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce Captain Carol Danvers! Yes, this is the first appearance of the woman who would be Miss Marvel and is currently Captain Marvel herself. In this case, she's Captain Paperwork, and the good citizen Avengers stick around to give their statements about what just happened. Which gives us time for a new flashback. This one goes back to prehistory, where we learn that the Kree Sentry used to check up regularly on a group of humans that the Kree had boosted the intelligence of generations before. And now, according to the Sentry, they have powers and are more than human. In fact, they should call themselves... Inhumans? We're then given Mar-Vell's backstory as well. Finally, we're treated to a nice couple of panels with Vision comforting Rick, who feels out of place, by telling him that superheroes are, by definition, misfits, and that's okay. It's actually kind of touching. We also get to see Clint Barton for the first time in this story as Goliath, one of his many super identities. This was based on him taking Hank Pym's growth serum to make him big and strong. He went to answer a call for help from the Wasp, Janet Van Dyne, who says that her husband Hank Pym, in this case dressed in his yellow jacket persona, was lost trying to rescue some researchers looking into a tropical section of the Arctic. Janet and Hank went to investigate, were attacked by a giant dragonfly that they started riding, and... Whoa! What the hell, Hank? Seriously, this is not the famous time he backhanded Janet. This is the lesser-known first time. Hank, you have a problem. Clint goes to find Hank, finds a gorilla lizard thing instead, and... Oh, look, there's Ronan and the Kree Sentry. Shortly thereafter, the rest of the Avengers show up, and we see that Ronan has brainwashed Clint into fighting on his side. More fighting, where we learn that Ronan's plan is to de-evolve all of Earth with a Kree Evo Ray that is slowly reverting everything by billions of years. Like how ice, years ago, used to be palm trees until it developed a mutation that allowed it to survive in the cold. I've taken to loving how comic books misunderstand evolution. The issue ends with us finding out that the gorilla lizard thing was indeed a de-evolved Hank Pym. Third issue starts with Hank finding Janet and instead of killing her, dragging her off for later, which is about as much euphemism as I can take. Meanwhile, Captain Marvel taunts Ronan, who overreacts as per usual. Mostly this is just fighting and Ronan monologuing until the end, when Ronan gets word that the Skrulls have attacked, quote, the entire Kree galaxy, showing that the writers know their cosmology just about as well as they know their evolution. So, three issues into this story, and finally the title event starts. The issue ends entirely with Hank Pym retiring from the Avengers to be a full-time researcher. Issue 4 starts with the Avengers and civvies relaxing, and I gotta say I love this. Especially Vision in a turtleneck, which also happens to be the name of my Justin Timberlake cover band. But that's ruined when Jarvis runs in with a newspaper and says that the researchers that they had rescued went to the press to tell what happened, and the US government, with a speed unknown in politics of any era, created an alien activities commission with absolutely no hint of irony or conception of historical context. H. Warren Craddock is leading it with exactly the fair-minded, truth-seeking level-headedness that you would expect. So, people immediately turn on the Avengers and surround the mansion, calling them traitors and demanding the release of Captain Marvel. Mar-Vell offers to give himself up, but the rest of the Avengers convince him that giving into fanaticism never helps. Carol Danvers comes back into our story by almost crashing a helicopter into the mansion and is rescued by Marvel and Vision, who reminds us that he normally doesn't wear clothes. This is also the issue where we start to see what will be the classic romance between Vision and Scarlet Witch. That's unrelated to the clothes comment. The Avengers convince Marvel to sneak off with Carol to a farmhouse upstate and hide until this all blows over. With a subtle bit of help from Nick Fury, who at this point still works for other people, and a reference to Japanese internment camps that actually works really well in this comic, they manage to escape. Rick Jones remembers being an orphan and how much he loved reading timely comics, which really does become important later. Goliath is tricked outside the mansion, the Avengers are served a summons. They go the next day to face the Alien Activities Committee, where the Fantastic Four shows up and throws them under the bus. The trial portion of our comic ends when Rick gets a telepathic warning that Marvel is in danger. The farmhouse was a trap. He runs away from the courtroom and the rest of the Avengers go home to find out that not only has the mansion been ransacked by an angry mob, Captain America, Iron Man, and Thor are there to kick them out and dissolve the team. Also, the Avengers apparently have bylaws. Issue 5 is giant-sized, but not a lot really happens. We open with Vision running in on Thor, Cap, and Iron Man, begging for help before passing out. They have no idea what's going on, but Hank Pym is there as Ant-Man and conveniently can tell us the Vision's backstory that all of these characters were present for. He can also potentially fix his android grandson. So he and a couple of his ant friends jump down Vision's throat, and we get most of an issue of Hank fighting his way past the android's internal security. It's fun and action-packed, but here's my favorite part. What it looks like is a leftover movie set from Metropolis. Fritz Lang's, not Clark Kent's. Just the place for an old EC fan addict like me. So, not only does timely comics exist in the Marvel Universe, which is well-established, but so does DC Comics and EC Comics. And Hank Pym is a reader of the latter. That is kinda cool, Marvel. Hank fixes Vision and flies off, at which point he explains what happened at the end of last issue to the shock and horror of the three original Avengers who don't remember disbanding anything. He explained that the other four rented a car and drove to Carol's farmhouse only to discover that the cows have death rays, and the Fantastic Four was there waiting to clobber them. But wait, how can that be? It's not the FF at all! It's a group of Skrulls, those shape-changing scamps, including the Super Skrull, that had been tricked into thinking that they were real cows in Fantastic Four number 2 a decade earlier. They're also the ones who disbanded the Avengers and pretended to be the FF in court. It all makes sense now. Captain Marvel and Carol Danvers had been captured by the Skrulls as well, and Marvel manages to break out and construct an Omni-Wave projector to warn the Kree that the Skrulls are trying to take Earth for... reasons. We don't know yet. But we do know that the Skrulls would love to have Omni-Wave technology to turn it from a communications device to a weapon. As soon as he finishes making it, he destroys it as he realizes that Carol is also really a Skrull. Marvel is recaptured as are Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch. Vision gets the rest of the Avengers to go help, but at this point the house has been revealed to be hiding a spaceship that takes off with the prisoners. Goliath tries to stop it, but he's running out of Pym particles and shrinks down to normal-sized Clint Barton, needing to be saved by Thor and setting up several issues of him angsting about not having superpowers again. Issue 6 has us starting with the three Skrulls the Super Skrull left behind when he exited. They've all been captured and one's struggling until Cap shoots him with a sedative ray. Like so much of Marvel in the Silver Age, this is an unnecessary dash in between the words, a personal pet peeve of mine that I'll get into another time. While they deal with the Skrulls they captured, we find out Vision, who's in love with Wanda, chased after the Super Skrull ship and fights with him while said Super Skrull attempts to blow up the Inhumans because of their connection to the Kree. That fails due to an Inhuman force field, but Vision calculates that even though he wants to save Wanda and, to a lesser extent, Pietro, he would lose in a fight with Super Skrull who can replicate the powers of the Fantastic Four. He leaves, while writer Roy Thomas makes use of that nifty thesaurus he got for the holidays. The Skrull ship travels to the Skrull galaxy in the Skrull homeworld, where the Skrull Emperor is challenged by the Skrull Super... Skrull. He's handily defeated, and Scarlet Witch, Quicksilver, and Captain Marvel are captured by the Skrull Emperor, who spends a lot of time yelling and belittling his much smarter daughter, Anel. The Skrull Emperor demands the secret of the Omniwave. Marvel refuses, so the Skrull Emperor tries to kill Wanda and Pietro by smothering them in belimbed tribbles. Marvel finally agrees. Back on Earth, the government sends a squadron of mandroids against the Avengers. Mostly reminded that at this point nobody knows that Tony Stark is Iron Man, when he reminds everybody that the mandroids were designed by Stark, so clearly his bodyguard knows their weaknesses. Despite that, the issue ends with Iron Man being thrown around like a ragdoll, and Triton of the Inhumans crawling out of a manhole a few feet away from the fight. Issue 7 begins with a flashback to an hour ago. Triton crawls out of the water and is immediately attacked by humans riled up with anti-alien fervor by Craddock. He escapes the sewer and... that's it. Gets to the end of last issue. Not very exciting. Nick Fury insults Craddock to distract him while Iron Man takes out the mandroids. This gives Triton time to exposit yet more goings-on in another location. In this case, he relates a story of Black Bolt and his brother, Maximus the Mad. Maximus took over Adelan, and Black Bolt has been wandering the streets of San Francisco with amnesia, basically being a silent homeless man with a preteen friend. It's crossover material that we're not covering here. Triton asks for help finding him, Cap says yes, but the Vision is having none of that and reminds them that they have captured teammates in need of rescue in another galaxy. Oh, and a war to stop that we haven't actually seen yet and hasn't really impacted any of these stories. Goliath suggests that they split the party, and Vision pretends to be entirely objective as he picks the strongest Avengers to go with him. Rescuing Black Bolt takes roughly a page. He has his memory back, and in the end, they also take the homeless kid with them. Why not? This isn't getting unwieldy or anything. Black Bolt... flashes back. It's like this was the template for Highlander the series. This time to provide backstory for his brother and that conflict. Mostly we learn that Maximus has made a deal with Ronan for the Inhumans to throw in with the Kree. Not happy that nobody consulted him, the King, Black Bolt fights with Maximus, driving him instantly insane literally by yelling at him. Back at the mansion, Vision feels bad for ignoring Triton to save Wanda and those other guys, I guess. Thor transports them to Adelan, which is still under a big black dome. Black Bolt arrives, whispers at it, and shatters the dome, revealing the Inhuman forces pointing lots of guns and angry that he broke their force field. There's a half a page of fight until Black Bolt yells at everyone to simmer down, y'all, and it turns out Maximus had them all under a spell which dissipates. Even Maximus is fixed. So glad Vision and crew went to take care of that subplot. Issue 8. So close. The Avengers go to get a ship from Nick Fury and head off to the Skrull Galaxy. Here's where we finally start to get to the actual war part of the Kree-Skrull War. The Avengers take on the Skrull Armada in some pretty epic fight scenes, though I have to say the Vision really needs to learn some battlefield tact. Go right ahead and keep telling them your weaknesses, boys. I'm sure no Skrull has ship-to-ship communications. The Avengers have a video conference with the Skrull Emperor who monologues them until he finds out, oh no, Captain Marvel hasn't been building an Omniwave device at all. He's already built one that... Huh? Okay, so he says it can project illusions, but why build one at all at risk of being captured? Meanwhile, back in Ronan's... palace? War room? Whatever. He's captured Rick Jones and is finally explaining why the Kree and Skrulls care about Earth at all. A simple question from a simple mind. Look at yonder... wait. Yonder what? Okay, I have to say it this way now. A simple question from a simple mind. Look at yonder Vorvis... Turns out that, so long as the Skrulls weren't fighting the Kree, nobody cared about Earth. But so long as they are fighting, it has vague strategic value that... oh, forget it. Even Rick gets bored with the explanation and tries to run, only to be stopped by Ronan, who really, somewhat creepily, wants this kid to like him. Ronan, the man who beat the steam engine, locks up Rick with the Intelligence Supreme. Here is where everything comes together. You see, IS was behind it all. He was the one using telepathic waves to guide everybody and everything across three galaxies instantaneously. He was the one who warned Rick about the farmhouse being a trap. He was the one who kept Captain Marvel from noticing the obvious trap. He was the one who had Rick captured and brought there. He had been telepathically urging Craddock into being a psychopath with a... congressional? Executive? Something committee! Basically, all of the interesting arguments about paranoia, trust, and our obligations to help those we can are pushed aside so a green blob can tie it all together. Personally, I prefer to think the Intelligence Supreme is crazy and only thinks he's been doing all this.
Oh yeah, Rick. See that bird? I'll make it flap its wings. Any minute now. There! I did that!
The crazy theory is brought out as the issue ends with Rick being thrown by the IS back into the negative zone, where Annihilus is always waiting no matter where you enter or exit. Finally, issue 9. We've come so far and seen so much to accomplish so little for so many. We pick up with Rick facing off against Annihilus, who looks like what happens when Dr. Robotnik goes on a bender and starts playing with the fabrication machine. This can be a problem for the young man with no powers other than the ability to flashback convincingly, which he does to catch up the readers at home. Annihilus tries to kill him, but Rick stops him with a beam of some sort from his forehead and then falls endlessly in void. Back at the Skrull Palace, Annihilus is still much smarter than her father, Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch are busting things up, and Captain Marvel has actually locked himself away with an Omniwave device. As he finishes it, he uses it to find out that Rick is in the negative zone and... destroys it again. This is the third one in this storyline. He also tries to explain why the Kree don't just use as a weapon, and basically the answer is, because Kree don't do that. Dateline, negative zone. Rick thinks about his situation, eventually thinks so hard that he punches a hole in reality and ends up back in our world, in the prison he was just in. Well done, young man. The Intelligence Supreme explains that what he's doing is the destiny of all humans. We'll all be able to think things into reality one day. And to prove it, Ronan attacks only to be foiled by an army of Golden Age Timely Comics heroes that Rick imagines into existence. See? I told you that would be important. Again, this is actually kind of cool and I dig the concept, if not that it came out of nowhere. Finally, Rickus X Maka Jones concentrates all of the Kree and all the Skrulls across three galaxies to freeze in place. Except the Intelligence Supreme. And they do. Also except H. Warren Craddock, who, surprise, was a Skrull the entire time, and using verbal hypnosis on everybody so people of Earth aren't really paranoid jerks, but innocent victims. It's all so neat. Rick falls over, and the Intelligence Supreme, presumably in control of Hala again, instantly transports all the protagonists there, where Captain Marvel is informed that to save the boy, he must merge bodies with him, giving up his hard-earned freedom from having to rely on Jones. Mar-Vell says goodbye and does so. They're all transported home, and nobody notices until Nick Fury points out that Goliath didn't come back with them, because to hell with Clint Barton, apparently. Honestly, I still really like this story, except for the ending, which is just too neat and tidy. The storytelling isn't generally my cup of tea, since I would rather one long story than a conglomeration of what are essentially a lot of meaningless subplots. But considering the time period, the pressure to not have plots lasting more than two or three books, and preferably told in just one, was enormous, and I can't fault Marvel for not always being ahead of their time. Otherwise, it's fairly typical Silver Age going into Bronze Age stuff that really didn't want to actually deal with a lot of these issues directly, only obliquely. But it has far-reaching consequences and laid the groundwork for much of what would happen in the Marvel Universe in the future. The reason why I bring it up in connection with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is that I think it gives us some clues as to what is going on. For example, if Skrulls exist in the show, are there any on Earth already? What characters have we seen that might be one, fan theories about Sky aside? Could this all be schematics for an Omniwave device that the Skrulls are trying to build and the Kree blood in Coulson and Garrett's system is impelling them to figure out? Who knows? And now for What Did We Learn, the part of the show that reviews important plot points that will affect future issues. 1. Vision hearts Wanda so much. 2. Clint Barton has had a number of superhero identities, almost as many as Hank Pym, but he wants real superpowers very badly. 3. Skrulls can be anywhere and anyone. 4. The Inhumans got to be that way because of the Kree. And finally, 5. Carol Danvers was the head of security at NASA and could make the Avengers stop and listen to her even before she had powers. That's it for this Kree-Skrull War plotline rundown. If there's a comic book plotline you want me to cover here, leave it in the comments. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.